me, the Lord says, all you who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, on you has the light shone. For Jesus Christ is the light of the world. And this is the story. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness could not put it out. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. I am the bright and morning star. So we join with the angels above in their hymns of praise. Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace. Hallelujah. He is risen. I invite you to join me in hymn number 270, The Haven of Rest. There is a place of quiet rest. Rise up and go from here in newness of strength to serve you, and to live life abundantly. Because you, Lord, are still Lord, our Lord, our Father, our Savior, our best friend. We worship you today. In the name of the one who died on the cross of Calvary for us. Amen. It's great to have folk at home joining us this morning as we worship the Lord and we study His Word together. Before the message, we're singing number 282, O Safe to the Rock That Is Higher Than I. If you feel like standing, you're welcome to do so as we sing.
This morning.
Please follow along as Rosie comes to read it for us. Psalm 61. At a time when David was at a low spot,
hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. When my heart is overwhelmed, lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Amen. For thou hast been a shelter for me and a strong tower from the enemy. I will abide in thy tabernacle forever. I will trust in the covert of thy wings, Selah. For thou, O God, hast heard my vows. Thou hast given me the heritage of those that fear my name. Fear thy name, sorry. Thou wilt prolong the king's life and his years as many generations. He shall abide before God forever. O prepare mercy and truth which may preserve him. So will I sing praise unto thy name forever, that I may daily perform my vows.
Amen. Thank you, Rosie. I suspect that David may have written this psalm on one of two occasions in his life. I think he could have written Psalm 61 even before he became king of Israel. Back when he was a very successful military officer in King Saul's army. He was so successful. He was so popular, it put his life in danger. David became a wanted man because King Saul was so jealous of his success and his popularity that King Saul would try to kill David over and over and over. It began one day in King Saul's home in Gibeah, where David, when he wasn't in battle, served as the royal musician. Just having David in the room stirred up King Saul's jealousy and anger, and he threw a spear across the room at David, but he missed. Now, King Saul is a great warrior. And at short distance, King Saul would not miss. Unless God had his hand on David. God spared David's life that day. But that wasn't the end of it. A short time later, Jonathan, Saul's son, learned of a plan his dad had devised to kill David. So he warns his best friend David. And David is able to escape. A short time later, Michael, Jonathan's sister, finds out about her dad's plot to kill David. And she warns him and helps him escape out the window and run for his life. So David went to the town of Ramah to stay with the prophet Samuel, the one who had ordained him to be the future king of Israel. Now you'd think that living in the prophet's home, in the home of the man of God, would be a safe place to hang out, right? No. Saul sent three posses of soldiers to assassinate David while he lived with the prophet, one after another. But every time a group of soldiers approached Samuel's home, they were stopped by God in their tracks, went into some kind of trance, and began prophesying, and forgot all about their mission to get rid of David. Three troops of soldiers, one after the other, all stopped by God. So finally Saul went to do the job himself. And when he got to the same place, God did the same thing to him. And he began prophesying. And then went back home. So David feared maybe the threat was over. So he returned to Gibeah to visit his good friend Jonathan. But Saul's temper flares up again, and Jonathan has to warn David. This time David flees to the town of Nob, where the tabernacle is, to see the priest Ahimelech. The priest prays for David, gives him some food and a sword, and sends him on his way. You'd think the tabernacle would be a safe place for David. But the royal shepherd, Doeg, just happened to be at the tabernacle that day and saw the priest helping David. And he rushed to seek the king and reported to him what he had witnessed. And King Saul sent soldiers to Nob to slaughter the priest and his whole family and to destroy the town of Nob. It was a bloody massacre. So David flees again. He escapes this time to Gath, the home of Goliath, in Philistine territory. Surely Saul could not touch him there. But the Philistines didn't trust David either, and he was not safe there. So he came halfway back towards Bethlehem, and hid out in the cave of Adullam in the middle of the desert. That's when some of his kinfolk gathered around him and camped with him in the wilderness. Some fugitives and outlaws and other misfits joined David there and became his merry men, his mighty men. David feared for his parents, that if Saul couldn't catch him, he might take out his jealousy and anger on his family. So he went and moved his parents to the country of Moab for their safety. Then he returns to the wilderness of Judah, but he constantly has to move from place to place to place to place, because no place was safe for David. From time to time, people like the local Ziphites would report to the king of David's whereabouts, hoping to gain favor with the king by telling on David. David didn't know who he could trust. No place felt safe day or night. This went on for 7 years until King Saul was finally died in battle. Did David write Psalm 61 while hiding in a cave in the wilderness? Maybe. I think it would fit. Let me read the psalm again. And listen for the words of a man who is running for his life, who is exhausted, who has no place to call home, who has no one he can trust but his God. In the NIV, it says, "Hear my cry, O God. Listen to my prayer. From the ends of the earth I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the foe. I long to dwell in your tent forever and take refuge in the shelter of your wings. For you, God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name. Increase the days of the king's life, his years for many generations. May he be enthroned in God's presence forever. Appoint your love and faithfulness to protect him. Then I will sing praise of it. Then I will ever sing in praise of your name and fulfill my vows day after day." Let's look at this chapter verse by verse. Verse 1. "Hear my cry, O God, attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee when my heart is overwhelmed." You ever been there? Overwhelmed? That's usually when you and I cry out to God for help, right? When we've tried everything else, when we're at the end of our rope, when we're fit to be tied, when nothing has worked, and we're out of ideas, there's no more options. Ever been in that place? Where you're overwhelmed by life, overwhelmed by the news, overwhelmed by the death of loved ones, when it's all too much, and we just can't cope anymore. David has been all over Palestine, running for his life, and no place is safe. He doesn't know who he can trust. The only person he truly trusts right now is the Good Shepherd. Do you know how he feels? What's his prayer in this place when he's feeling overwhelmed? Verse 2. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee when my heart is overwhelmed. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. Or that could be translated, lead me to the rock that is too high for me to reach on my own. Because way up on the mountain is a safe place if nobody else can reach me there. If no one can harm me, there I can rest. Our daughter Kimberly loves mountain climbing. This is Kimberly going up a cliff. She loves the solitude. The steeper, the more barren the cliff, the better. No one can touch her. She is perfectly safe there. At the top is an oasis, a place to rest. If you don't fall, it's a wonderful place to be, they tell me. I have never joined her in this pursuit. If you've ever watched the Lion King movie, you know what Pride Rock is. King Mufasa would stand on the top of the highest rock outcrop in his African kingdom. And from there, he could survey his whole kingdom. He could address all his subjects. He could lead his loyal followers. Up there, he was safe from anyone who would attack him, who would try to assassinate him. He was safe up there from the arrows of the evil one. David can't do these things because he's busy hiding behind the rocks, living in caves. He can't show his face. He can't trust anyone. He's longing for the safety and security of being way up on the mountain. He's longing for life to be normal. You and I, looking back, we know that when David speaks of the rock that is higher than I, it should have a capital R. Because Jesus is the rock that is higher than I. He is the rock of our salvation. Jesus is our resting place, our rock of ages, cleft for me. If you wanted to feel perfectly secure and safe, where would you go? Some people would seek a castle or a fortress with bars on the windows, triple locks on the doors, a good alarm system, watchdogs in the yard, and alligators in the moat roundabout. Others prefer a bomb shelter underground with a year's supply of water, food, and batteries for their cell phone. Sound good? Others, in order to feel secure, only need to check with their financial planner. And as long as their nest egg is safe, and the stock market is up, and their life insurance is paid up, and RRSP is maxed out, they feel secure. As long as the war stays on the other side of the globe, and as long as the COVID numbers don't come way back up, we feel secure. David is not looking for any of those things. What makes David feel secure? Verse 3. For thou hast been a shelter or a refuge for me, a strong tower from the enemy. In Old Testament times, people gathered to worship God in a big tent called the tabernacle. God would meet with his people there. And if someone should accidentally contribute to the death of another person, or even be accused of murder, the relatives of the deceased would hunt down the accused to seek revenge, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth. In those days, there was no time for something called a trial by jury. Justice was swift. So God made a provision. If the death was truly an accident, the accused could hide in God's big tent, the tabernacle, and there they would be safe, guaranteed by God. Now, when I think of a safe place, a tent would not be my first choice. Have you ever tented in a windstorm? There is not much protection from a storm in a tent. Have you ever awakened in a wet tent after a nighttime thunderstorm? That is no fun. A tent can't even protect you from mosquitoes or earwigs or from the neighbor's boombox. A tent can't even keep out the cold. Honestly, would you feel safe in a tent if you knew there was a bear or even a skunk outside? Would you want to be living in a tent in a national park somewhere in the Ukraine this week? A tent is no protection. But look at verse 4. I will abide in thy tabernacle, in thy tent, forever. I will trust in the refuge of thy wings. Why would an accused killer feel safe in the tabernacle, in a big tent? Why does David think that he would be secure in God's tent? Only because God is there. It's not the tent that made David feel safe, but God had promised to protect his children the way a shepherd protects his sheep, or like a mother hen protects her chicks under her wings. In God's tent, in God's presence, David could lay down and sleep with both eyes shut. No worries, no fear, because Almighty God was standing guard. And he who watches over Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps. So while God stands guard, David can snore in God's tent, sleeping like a baby. The tent is no protection, but being in God's presence brings peace, brings shalom, provides security and safety. In God's presence, there is no need to worry. That's where I want to dwell, with David in God's dwelling place. Because in God's presence, there is liberty, there is joy, there is love. In God's presence, there is calmness, there is renewal and refreshment. With that in mind, let's hear the words of Psalm 61 again, this time in the New American. Hear my cry, O God. Give your attention to my prayer. From the end of the earth I call to you when my heart is faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I. For you have been a refuge for me, a tower of strength against the enemy. Let me dwell in your tent forever. Let me take refuge in the shelter of your wings. For you have heard my vows, God. You have given me the inheritance of those who fear your name. You will prolong the king's life. His years will be like generations. He will sit enthroned before God forever. Appoint faithfulness and truth that they may watch over him. So I will sing praise to your name forever, that I may pay my vows day by day. Now there's one other occasion where I think David could have written Psalm 61. This is when he is an old man, but still ruling as king in Jerusalem. His third oldest son, Absalom, wanted his father to retire so that he could become king. Absalom found himself in a similar situation to Prince Charles. Tired of waiting to become king. So Absalom came up with a plan, and it's ingenious. He began sitting at the gate to the palace every day to greet people who were coming to see the king. And everyone who came, Absalom would say, "Oh, I'm sorry, but the king is too busy to see you today. May I help you?" And he listened and he helped every one of them with their problems. And it wasn't long till Prince Absalom was loved by the whole country. Eventually, Absalom gathered a great crowd of followers, advisors, and warriors with horses and chariots ready to take the throne by force. So in 2 Samuel 15, King David once again has to run for his life. With his wives, his children, his grandchildren, his servants, and thousands of loyal friends, they had to flee the capital city. Once again being hunted like a wild animal, this time by his own boy. King David and his family marched together across the Kidron Valley, up the Mount of Olives, and out towards the desert. Absalom's army chased his father and caught up with him at Bathrim, which many scholars believe is the city of Nob. Tell me, honestly, how would you feel if one of your children just couldn't wait another day for you to die so they could inherit? So they go out and they arrange doctor-assisted suicide for you as a gift for your birthday. Can you imagine what David is feeling, being hunted by his own boy, having to run for his life and hide like an animal? Perhaps David penned Psalm 61 at such a time as this. Verse 5 says, "For thou, O God, hast heard my vows. Thou hast given me the heritage of those that fear thy name." David doesn't know how many days he's got left on this earth. So he's thanking God for the blessing of a godly heritage. He's thanking God for the privilege of growing up among the people of God, for being part of the family of God. He's recognizing what a privilege it is. Verse 6. "Thou wilt prolong the king's life, and his years shall be as many generations." I don't know if he here is praying in his younger days. It'd be King Saul he's praying for a long life for. Or whether in his older years he's praying for himself. that God would give him more days. Verse 7. The king shall abide before God forever. Oh, prepare mercy and truth, that they may preserve him. So will I sing praise unto thy name forever, that I may daily perform my vows. David is vowing to dwell in the Lord's presence for the rest of his life. How many days or years he has left. If God will be merciful to him once again, he will dwell in the presence of God every day of his life. There are many things in this world that can make us feel insecure. Losing a job, falling into debt, getting dumped by a boyfriend, traveling down the highway at 110 kilometers an hour while other people are passing you, moving to a new town, retiring, a death in the family, the war in Ukraine, the cost of everything going up, COVID numbers going back up. Do you remember as children, we thought there were monsters living in our bedroom, or maybe ghosts, because we saw shadows, we heard noises, we got that eerie feeling in the pit of our stomachs, and I would cry, or I would call for my parents. And in no time, my parents were in the doorway, and they turned on the light. Now, I know nothing really changed, but in that instant, all those bad feelings left. I was fine as soon as Mom and Dad showed up. Because I knew nothing, nothing in this world could harm me if Mom and Dad were there. I was perfectly safe in my parents' presence. In the same way, when we run to our Heavenly Father, or when we cry out to Jesus, or better yet, when we dwell in His presence each and every day, we could not be in a safer place, no matter who or what is out to get us. This morning, the Heavenly Father is inviting us into his tent. He's inviting us to abide in his presence. If you are afraid this morning, he invites you to rest in the back seat and leave the driving to him. If you are worried about the future, he invites you to put your trust in Christ, to relax, and start enjoying life again, letting God do the worrying for you. If you find yourself afraid for your children and your grandchildren's safety in a dangerous world, the Heavenly Father invites you to entrust your family to His loving care. Will you enter this morning His divine presence? Will you draw up close to Him? Will you come into His tent and experience His peace? And leave the worry to our Heavenly Father. If you are not experiencing security and peace found only in the arms of the Good Shepherd, you may want to pray while the rest of us sing, I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Let's join Bill and Pat as we sing together. Thank you. Before all time, and now, and forevermore.